Hi, folks. Pastor Craig coming at you today for another midday moment. Different circumstances today. I'm actually coming to you from the sanctuary of Emeryville Church of Christ. Some of you know where that is, over here on the highway heading towards Irwin, up the river road there. As it turns out, Miss Tammy had an uncle that passed away, and we've gone to be at that graveside today, and they invited us for lunch. So we've come over to stay here at the and have lunch with her family today, and the pastor was nice enough to allow me in to utilize their Wi-Fi. If you've gone down the river road before, you know that the river going down towards Irwin has no internet signal. If you ever tried to do that before, you know what I'm talking about. So I'm actually sitting in their foyer using their Wi-Fi. So that's why the background looks a little different. And I try to find a spot here. I didn't want to be too intrusive and go look for another spot in their church. So I just hung right here at the foyer where I could be out of sight, out of mind kind of a thing. And not be too nosy into the church business. But I do want to spend just a minute or two with you, have some prayer, and get into our study for today. I didn't want to miss the opportunity to sort of teach you something today. So we want to go to the Lord in prayer, as we always do at this time, and ask God's blessing. Obviously, I'll not have a song today, but I still think that God's got a good word for somebody today. To challenge you, where do you find yourself? Particularly, I'm talking about in the midst of temptation, to encourage your hearts that there is victory to be known over the temptation in your life. But let's pray together, then we'll get into our study. Amen. Father God, I thank you for the blessings, Lord, of life. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the testimony that Uncle Wayne left behind. And I do pray your blessings on the family today as they gather together for lunch and fellowship together, Lord. As one of the aunts was saying, Lord, it's unfortunate that it takes a death in a family to get everybody together, but I think many of our families would testify to that same situation. But God, I pray your blessing upon them today and comfort their hurting hearts and fill that emptiness in their life with your love and your presence. And Lord, I pray your blessing on those that our heart goes out to, many others that are sick in body, families that are bearing up under burdens and obstacles of life, and Lord, moms and dads that are worried, and grandmas and grandpas, and I pray, God, your blessings on those that need a touch from you today, be it physical or emotional or spiritual, maybe very physical, maybe financial. God, I pray your blessing that you provide and prove yourself to be faithful, Lord, that your people need desperately for you to be. So again, bless this time together in your word. I pray, God, it will be a blessing to those that need an encouragement today. And I'll thank you in advance for what you do for us. So forgive my sin, cleanse me of the sin of my heart, the sin of my mind, and let me be a vessel that you can use today for your glory. And I'll gladly thank you for it all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, today we come back to our series that I called Things That the Devil Would Rather You Not Know, Things That the Devil Won't Tell You. And if you remember, on Monday of this series, I simply outed the devil and basically said that he is the great deceiver. I called him out and let you realize who he is and what he is, the great deceiver. Tuesday, we examined the idea that life is brief and we must prepare today. Wednesday, we saw the fact that lost people do still go to hell. And thankfully, bless the name of the Lord, yesterday, I remembered it, or reminded you that Jesus is still the only way to get to God. So number five in this series today, I believe that Satan would rather you not know that you can have victory over the temptations that he places before you. Whatever that looks like, the things that tempt you may not tempt me. You have your own vices, you have your own weaknesses, and the devil is fully aware of that. But today, the truth of the matter is, based on what the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 13, there is victory to be known over temptation in your life. Listen to 1 Corinthians 10, 13. No temptation has taken you but such as is common to man, and God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, so that you'll be able to endure it. The truth of the matter before us all today, dear friend, is that temptation is a fact of life for all of us. Excuse me, you read in Luke chapter number 4 that even Jesus was tempted by Satan there in the wilderness. So the question that comes before us a lot of times is, why are some people seemingly able to withstand temptation and others are not? How can some folks come through temptation seemingly unscathed while others are completely ruined by the fall? Is there some kind of a secret? That's the question before us. Is there some kind of a secret to be known to make it, whatever it looks like, while others don't seem to be able to? Well, I think the secret I want to give you today is that to understand that problem more fully, I'm going to give you three lies that the devil will often tell you. Three lies that the devil loves to use when it comes to God's people trying to stand up under temptation. And they're all suggested for us right there in Paul's letter, where he says there in 1 Corinthians 10:13. I suggest to you that those that are continually falling in and failing, I guess say, in their battle with temptation is because they've bought into one, two, maybe all three of these lies. And those are able to, quote unquote, make it are the ones that have simply chose to cling to the truth of God's word because they recognize the deceiver, they know who he is, and they reject him and the lies that he is trying to present to them. So let me restate that text for you. Let me paraphrase what Paul has said here in 1 Corinthians 10:13. He simply says it in common language. He says, remember that the temptations that come into your life are no different from what other folks have experienced in their life. And he adds this, and he said, and God is faithful. God is faithful that he will keep you from the temptation becoming so strong that you can't stand up against it. And when you are tempted, he'll show you a way out so that you'll not give in to it. See, the devil don't want you to be encouraged, child of God, by those type words. Here's the first temptation, temptation number one. Temptation lie number one, put it that way. Number one lie that the devil will tell you oftentimes is that no one else goes through what I'm going through. Nobody else is being tempted like I'm being tempted. Let me tell you this, there are no such things as special cases when it comes to sin. There are none that are excused simply because they have more or somehow different temptations than others. Paul says that the temptations that come into your life are no different from what other folks are experiencing or have experienced. And Satan would love for you to believe that. Satan would love for you to be convinced that your trials and your temptations are different and that you stand alone in what it is that you're battling under. And here's the reason why. Here's why he'd love for you to believe that. When God's people gets to the point of thinking that they're the only one experiencing a particular temptation, it becomes easy for me to be reluctant, let's say, to reach out for help. We it's our very nature that sin always brings a certain level of shame into a Christian life. And as a result, we're embarrassed to deal with it. We're embarrassed to bring it out into the daylight. We just we'll convince ourselves that folks just won't understand, they'll judge me, they'll look at me differently. And it's easy to adopt that first lie that nobody else is going through what I'm going through. Then we don't feel any obligation to ask for help. We don't feel any obligation to go to a sister or a brother in the Lord and say, hey, I need to talk to somebody. Because the truth is, without the help of other people, Satan knows there's little, if any, chance of you making it through that time of temptation. God intended this church to be a body of believers helping one another. I was excited by that fact today that the pastor said, sure. I told him what I'd do at noon, and he didn't even hesitate. Opened up the door, gave me the Wi-Fi password, and I think that's what it's supposed to be. One of the major functions of the local church, regardless of the denomination that hangs over the door, is to be an encouragement one to another. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11, Paul says, you encourage one another and build each other up. He said, brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those that are lazy, encourage those that are timid, take care of those that are weak, be patient with everybody. When I'm going through, when we are going through times of temptation in our life, we need to know that we can count on our church family to get us through. When you see a fellow believer that's caught up in sin, your heart ought to break for them. You ought to reach out to them and know how tough it is for them. Know that what they're going through is really no different than what you've gone through in times of your life and how torn up you felt on the inside. Don't ever look down on somebody because of the sin of their life. Instead of judging them for the sake of a judgment, our attitude ought to be to reach out and comfort them and to bring them back into good relations and good fellowship with the Lord. Scripture teaches that there will be a time for judgment, but there's also a time of restoration. There's also a time for us to restore that person back to faith. So don't ever feed the idea that you're alone in your temptation. That's just setting you up for failure. Temptation lie number two that the devil will often tell God's people is that this temptation is just too strong for me to resist. Folks have let the devil convince them that their problem is with sin is just too big for them to cope with, too much for them. And the excuse oftentimes when they fall to sin and are victims of sin in their life, they'll declare, well, I just couldn't help myself. After all, preacher, don't we all have a sinful nature? We've all got that fleshly nature, right, preacher? Yeah, we do. We all have a sinful nature. And we all have that point that we come to where our will by itself is not strong enough. Just sort of accept that. In and of yourself, your will is not strong enough. That's why Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 10:13, he says, but what? But God is faithful. God is faithful. God is faithful. And he says he'll keep the temptation of being so strong that you can't stand up against it. Listen closely. Again, I've said it before. I'm not speaking to everybody, but I think I'm speaking to somebody. I've got good news for somebody today. God knows exactly what your breaking point is. And because he's merciful, he's promised to never let you be tempted beyond that point. So I think the logic here sounds something like this. If you're going to be tempted, then know that it's a temptation that God knows that I'm strong enough to resist. Otherwise, he would not allow it to come into my life. The reason that particular misconception has so much appeal to folks, though, is that it used to be true. Think about it. There was times in my life before I was redeemed by sin that we were all enslaved to that. There was a time in your life that you could say, and it would be true, I could not help myself. It was too much for you because it was your very nature to sin. But Paul writes in Romans chapter 3, verse number 24, that I have been justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So it is with us. We were once enslaved to sin. We once had no choice, no opportunity to be free from the power of sin in our life, but Jesus had compassion on us. Being rich in mercy, being rich in grace, he paid the required price with his own sinless life. And now, as a glorious result, though my fleshly nature may still be compelled to sin, I'm no longer under the control of that sin. All because of what Christ did on Calvary. He redeemed me. And for that, we ought to lift our hands and glorify him for who he is and what he's done in our life and praise his glorious name because of that. Temptation lie number three. The only way for me to get out is to give in. The only way for me to get out is to give in. And again, to refute this lie number three, I take you again back to 1 Corinthians 10:13, where Paul says that when you're tempted, not if, but when you're tempted, he'll show you a way out so that you'll not give in to it. Oftentimes, the way of escape from that temptation is actually easier than you might think. And it's all a matter of priority. Here's what I mean by that. If my priority in my life is to live a holy life, if I'm determined with the help of the Holy Spirit of God, I want to live a life that's holy and acceptable in the eyes of God, you'll find a way out. No matter what the consequence may be, it may involve you not putting yourself in that place. It may involve you putting a block on your internet so that you're not surfing to those channels and those sites and those places that you know you don't need to be. I'll find different friends. I'll run in different circles if that's my priority. If your Christian walk, if your Christian testimony is not your highest priority, if your spiritual life has taken a back seat to your comfort and your convenience, or to money and relationships, or to what other people think of you, if your spiritual life is second priority in your life, then you're going to find it easy to believe the lie that there's no way out. What the devil doesn't want you to know today, dear friend, is that there's always a way out of temptation. When tempted in the wilderness, what did Jesus do? How did Jesus overcome temptation? Well, he overcame temptation by the word of God. Every time the devil would throw something at him, he would respond with the word of God. The devil says, dut, 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 dut. But Jesus says, yes, but the word of God says, dut, 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 dut. God's authoritative, holy word says that we can succeed in living a holy life. Thanks be to God. Write down 1 Corinthians 15, 15. And go be to God, which is victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 18. Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 18. For in that he himself hath suffered being tempted, he is able to help or to aid or assist or to succor, whatever translation, he's able to help those that are being tempted. James chapter 4, verse number 7. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. It's all about priorities. What do I place as the most important in my life? So I'll leave you with three key truths today. One, the devil is the only one that'll ever tempt you to sin, and he tempts all of God's people. Be encouraged by that, child of God. You're not in this boat tempted any more harshly or any more than anyone else. Others have successfully faced temptations, the same temptations that you're facing upon. Point number two, we don't have to give in to temptation. He promises to give us what we need to be successful. And then lastly, our best weapon is Scripture is the best weapon against temptation and the best reminder that God is with us through the midst of it. The devil would tempt us to get our eyes off of God's word, to get us to not trust in him. But this truth be known from the example of Jesus in the desert, that our best weapon, our best defense against Satan is our knowledge of the word of God. Amen. I had originally planned to only bring five lessons this week. I was going to wrap this particular series up today, but I believe God's got one more for me to deliver. So come back Monday at high noon, for I've got a word of encouragement.